Welcome back, geology fans. Today we imagine that you have completed your background investigations and gotten your gear together for your trip, and now you've touched down on your site of investigation. What should be your next steps, and how should you conduct yourself to ensure safety and good data collection? There is no set list of steps to follow, as each location may have to be approached in novel ways, but you should have your general strategy mapped out before arriving in the field. Be prepared. Your strategy may or may not involve some of the concepts we will discuss here, but these ideas are valid in most cases. I've previously suggested viewing the HBO episode From the Earth to the Moon on the Apollo 15 mission called Galileo Was Right. A lot of what I'm going to talk about today is covered in that episode, and that is no mere coincidence nor plagiarism. Lee Silver was the Caltech geologist featured in that episode, but it should be no surprise that there were a team of geologists in the field training the astronauts, and anyone who knows anything about the geology of the Apollo missions knows the name Bill Mulberger, a geologist I first encountered as an undergraduate student at UT Austin. He was my most influential field geology instructor there. And I hear Bill in that film telling his students to get to the high ground, to get the big picture first, to note the usual suite of rocks, but to keep an eye out for the unusual one. Always keep an eye on the context of each individual rock, and be sure your notes are so detailed that some other geologist could read it and know exactly what you meant. For one day, you will be that other geologist wondering what your vague scribblings meant 30 years ago. Let's start with what you put in your field notebook. Details. Yes, you need to note the details. This includes where you are both physically and emotionally. Start each mission with a general header of location and goals, but each day of the mission should probably start on a new page with the date, mission goal for that day, the weather, and how you're feeling. Are you full of energy and ready to go? Or are you sick, or even worse, hungover or otherwise affected physically or emotionally? You are the filter through which the data comes, so, geologist, know thyself. Be suspicious of data taken while feeling sick or run down. Focus on data from the good days, which you'll have more of if you've gotten in shape for your excursions in the weeks before you get out to your study site. A general rule is to get the big picture first and then work down into the details. In the old days, this usually meant climbing up to the highest point to get a good view, but today we have airplanes and satellites and Google Earth, which you should have already looked at before getting to your field site, so you may be able to skip hiking up to the highest point if you feel you have that scale of the big picture down already. These days I use drones to get a good overview of a field location, and to do some other types of mapping like high-resolution 2D images, so-so vegetation maps, digital elevation maps, which we call DEMs, and 3D maps of the site. The principle of getting the big picture first holds at many scales. So, for example, if you are approaching a rock outcrop, you want to start by looking at it from a distance, in its context, then moving in closer to get details. This means if you're at a road outcrop, you might have to start out standing on the opposite side of the road and maybe ask yourself the following questions, which you could also ask yourself during your pre-field preparation research. Is there one kind of rock, or many kinds? And do the various rock structures look as if they continue or once continued beyond the edges of the visible rock outcrop? Or do they end suddenly within the outcrop? And if they end suddenly, against what? Can you tell if the rock is truncated by a fault, an unconformity, an intrusive cross-cutting feature? Turn your attention to the edges of the outcrop. Does it end suddenly or grade into soil or rock debris? And do you think that you can see why the outcrop ends where it does? Do you think you can tell what kind of rock it is from the fact that sedimentary rocks are usually layered and tabular, while metamorphic and igneous crystalline rocks have a more massive or jointed appearance? Sketch the various rock bodies you see and note how they control the shape of the outcrop itself. Try to discern both from a distance and as you get closer, the nature of the boundaries between the different rock units. Are the contacts gradational or sharp? And do they cut across any prominent patterning or grain in rock on either side of the boundary? Does the color or any other prominent feature change in either of the rocks approaching the boundary? If the rocks are layered, describe layer thickness, lateral continuity, internal structure that is or is not parallel to the bounding surfaces. The bounding surfaces means the main bedding planes of the layers. Remember that distinguishing bounding surfaces from crossbed surfaces is very important when you measure crossbedded sediments. Keep asking these questions and see if any of your answers change as you approach the outcrop. What was the color or any other feature from far away and as you approach? When finally up against the rock outcrop, collect samples from the various rock bodies and any other variable parts. Sometimes you can just scoop some up or pluck it by hand, but this is often where the hammer comes in. Listen to your hammer hitting the rock. Does the rock crumble or crack? Does the hammer hit with a thud of softer rock like shale or ring like a metamorphic or igneous crystalline rock? I often say I don't do geology from pictures as it robs me of 4 of my 5 senses. Don't forget to smell that rock for sulfur or petroleum, taste it for salts, or see if that clay or bone sticks to your tongue. Feel its texture and weight. Experience your field site in every way you can and pay attention to what you're sensing, be it the typical or the unusual. And while listening to the sound your hammer makes on the rock, go ahead and break it. Geologists are one of the leading causes of mechanical weathering. The outside of a rock is its weathering rind, and you have to crack it open to see its fresh, original face. You know, rocks are like children. They lie, so we beat them, and then they tell the truth. Use that hand lens to get details on both weathered and fresh faces. Try some hydrochloric acid to test for effervescence, or even put some water on to clean the rock's surface, or see how well the rock absorbs the water. Start noting all you can, or at least all you think is important. This could be overall rock weathering or mineral alteration, porosity, grain size, and all those other primary and secondary sedimentary features we mentioned earlier in this series. Crystal size, any fabric, that is, preferred direction to the crystals or grains, and if you can tell mineralogy, try to estimate percent volume of the various minerals in the rock. Give the best guess to the name of the rock, getting as specific as possible. Are there any signs of deformation in the rock at all? Maybe you saw some folding from a distance, or maybe you can only see signs of deformation as you get in closer. Measure faults and joints, specifically note major faults and principal fault and joint directions. Minor faults are also noted, as with their spacing and individual throw. Throw being the distance the rocks on either side of the fault moved relative to each other. If you find a nice sample you want to collect, sample bags come in handy. While collecting samples, don't get too focused on the odd outliers. Collecting samples of the typical can help you back at camp or in the less inspirational office as well. Getting a good idea of the typical lets you better see the unusual. You'll get really good at noticing the unusual rock and often calculate the weight, distance to base, energy, and water left to tell if you're going to haul it back or just take pictures. And if you take pictures, taking notes about these pictures so you can properly identify them later. Rocks can be really heavy, so don't misjudge and carry something a kilometer or more that you're just going to drop later in the day, thus wasting energy. Since most rocks you'll be interested in will be too large to carry, break off a smaller piece or draw and take pictures with notes of location, direction you are facing, and details in context. I am no artist, that's for sure, but practice sitting down a distance from a rock outcrop and drawing in every detail you can. You might be surprised. And if you're not the fossil whisperer, as I am not nor most of my colleagues, draw or take a picture and send that to your paleontologist buddy to identify for you, or refer to a handy reference book. Once all these issues have been noted, and you're still out in the field, this is a good point to pause and go over all your notes so far and congeal your ideas. Now you may have a good idea of what more specific observations and notes you may want to take, also keeping in mind how much more ground you want to cover and the time that you have. So let's say you've wrapped up at your first rock exposure and are ready to set off for your next exposure. Don't consider a path to the next goal useless ground. You shouldn't have to come back to an area you've already covered. So if you see something of interest or something you can measure as you're walking between point A and point B, put it down in your book and map it while you're there. Be consistent in how you measure. Don't drop your guard and be confident as well. Do not be shy to ink your map in the field, as it is the best place to do so. The hotel or tent that night is seriously inferior, though that's orders of magnitude better than back in the office a week later. Again, be a confident geologist. Never say, I can't, but I will try, or I can't yet. After all, you're smart and determined enough to be watching this series, so please don't be hesitant to commit to your mapping in the field. It is the best place to do it, and don't expect any angels of enlightenment to come down on you later. But to put another angle on enlightenment, we're going to look at how to use what is known as a Jacob's staff in measuring rock sections and constructing stratigraphic columns when we come back next time here on Earth Explorations.